All right, 2 Kings chapter 9. If you'll turn there in your Bibles as we continue our study through the Word. We've been watching the ministry of Elisha, and you remember last time how we left off where King Joram had been out battling against the king of Syria at Ramoth-Gilead, and the Syrians had wounded him. And so he ends up now coming, and Ahaziah, the son of Jehoram, king of Judah, went down to see Joram, who is the son of Ahab, there in Jezreel. And so we pick it up here, and we're going to see now the cleansing of the influence of Ahab. You remember that Ahab was wicked king. You remember that he was married to Jezebel. And so now we have their son. And Joram is the son of Ahab and Jezebel. And we're going to see the destruction of Joram. We're going to see also Jezebel's demise as well. We get to see Jezebel dies now. We're going to see the end of her influence upon the nation and just the wickedness that was in her heart and how it permeated and pervaded. And so we're going to see this cleansing. God is going to raise up Jehu and is going to call him now to go and to cleanse and bring the judgment upon Ahab's descendants. Now, you remember that when Elijah had told Ahab that God was going to judge him and that his sons were all going to be cut off, you remember that Ahab repented and he was in sackcloth. And you remember that God then said that he was going to bring about this judgment, but it wasn't going to happen immediately. It was going to happen later. And so there was mercy upon Ahab himself that was given. But now the time for judgment has come, the time for cleansing, a time to head in the right direction. And so we're going to see how God raises up and calls Jehu to go ahead and to be his instrument that he uses now. So 2 Kings chapter 9, beginning in verse 1. And Elisha the prophet called one of the sons of the prophets and said to him, "Get yourself ready. Take this flask of oil in your hand and go to Ramoth-Gilead. And now when you arrive at that place, look there for Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, the son of Nimshi, and go in and make him rise up from among his associates and take him to an inner room. And then take the flask of oil and pour it on his head and say, 'Thus says the Lord, I have anointed you king over Israel.' And then open the door and flee and do not delay." Now, go anoint him king and then get out of there as fast as you possibly can. Now, I want you to remember that actually Elijah was the one that had been commissioned by God to go and to anoint Jehu as the king over Israel. That was back in 1 Kings chapter 19. And the Lord told Elijah, "Also you shall anoint Jehu, the son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat, Abel Meholah, you shall anoint as prophet in your place." And so we see that there were two directives that God had given to Elijah at the end when he was about to be taken up, and that was to go ahead and to establish Elisha as the prophet after him in your place. And then also he was to go and to anoint Jehu as the king. And so we see that the assignment to go fell onto Elisha's shoulders. And so then Elisha passes it on to this other one of the young prophets that was underneath his tutelage. And so he sends him now to go to Jehu. Now, Jehu was the commander of Joram's army. So he's the general that's in charge. So he's to go to the general. While Joram is still the king, he's to go to the general and anoint him as the king over Israel. Then there'll be two kings. And then run as fast as you can. Get out of there. And so here we see in verse 4, so the young man, the servant of the prophet, went to Ramoth-Gilead. And when he arrived, there were the captains of the army sitting. And he said, I have a message for you, commander. And Jehu said, for which one of us? And he said, for you, commander. So the young prophet goes and he finds Jehu outdoors. And there they are sitting, and he is sitting amongst his fellow officers. And so he approaches and says that he has a message for him. And Jehu now, you know, inquires for which one, and he tells him that it's for you directly. And so verse 6, we see that he goes inside with them just as he was instructed. Then he arose and went into the house. And he poured the oil on his head and said to him, thus says the Lord God of Israel, I have anointed you king over the people of the Lord, over Israel. And you shall strike down the house of Ahab, your master, that I may avenge the blood of my servants, the prophets, and the blood of all the servants of the Lord at the hand of Jezebel. And so the prophet here now anoints Jehu, you know, brings him in. You have a message for me. And the next thing you know, he's pouring the oil onto his head and he is anointing him. And then he speaks to him and commissions him from the Lord and tells him, now, thus says the Lord God of Israel, I have anointed you king over the people of the Lord, over Israel. No doubt Jehu had woken up like any other day. He's sitting there with his officers, and the next thing you know, God taps him on the shoulder, sends a prophet to him, anoints him, and tells him, you are now king. And God says, I'm going to use you as an instrument to avenge the innocent blood that Ahab and Jezebel had shed. In verse 8, for the whole house of Ahab shall perish, and I will cut off from Ahab all the males in Israel, both bond and free. And so I will make the house of Ahab like the house of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, and like the house of Baasha, the son of Ahijah. The dogs will eat Jezebel on the plot of ground at Jezreel, and there shall be none to bury her. And he opened the door and fled. So there you go. Have a good kingdom. I have to go see a man about a dog right now. And out he goes. And so he departs. Now, here again, you'll remember after the when God judges and sends Elijah to King Ahab. That's recorded back in 1 Kings chapter 21. And it says, then the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, arise, go down to meet Ahab, king of Israel, who lives in Samaria. And there he is in the vineyard of Naboth, where he has gone down to take possession of it. Now, you remember when he was upset because he couldn't have Naboth's vineyard that was next to him. And then Jezebel says, why are you downcast? I'll get you the vineyard. And she goes and has Naboth killed. And so there now Ahab was in the vineyard. And so Elijah comes to Ahab when he was in that vineyard, and that's when judgment was pronounced on him. There he is in the vineyard of Naboth, where he has gone down to take possession of it. And you shall speak to him, saying, thus says the Lord, have you murdered and also taken possession? And you shall speak to him, saying, thus says the Lord, in the place where dogs licked the blood of Naboth, dogs shall lick your blood, even yours. And so Ahab said to Elijah, have you found me, O my enemy? And so he answered, I have found you because you have sold yourself to do evil in the sight of the Lord. And behold, I will bring calamity on you And I will take away your posterity and cut off from Ahab every male in Israel, both bond and free. And I will make your house like the house of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, and like the house of Baasha, the son of Ahijah, because of the provocation with which you have provoked me to anger and made Israel sin. And concerning Jezebel, the Lord also spoke, saying, the dogs shall eat Jezebel by the wall of Jezreel. And the dog shall eat whoever belongs to Ahab and dies in the city, and the birds of the air shall eat whoever dies in the field. And this is when Ahab heard those words, he tore his clothes and put sackcloth onto his body. And then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, and it says, see how Ahab has humbled himself before me. Because he has humbled himself before me, I will not bring the calamity in his day, but in the days of his son, I will bring the calamity on his house. And so here we see that this was prophesied through Elijah, the cutting off of Ahab's family. So now Jehu, who is the commander, he's the general, suddenly he is anointed the king, and this prophet goes running out, goes past the other officers that were sitting there. And now Jehu comes back out from the house, and there are the officers that are sitting there. In verse 11, it says, and then Jehu came out to the servants of his master, and one said to him, is all well? Why did this madman come to you? And he said to them, you know the man and his babble. You know, he tries to play it off as if nothing happened, you know, but the fact that he's got olive oil all over his head now, and this guy goes running out, it's like, okay, verse 12, and they said, a lie! Tell us now. They're like, we know something has happened. And so, sensing that the prophet's mission was important, they wanted to know what has just happened. What just happened? We were just sitting here talking about the Super Bowl next week, and the next thing, you know, this madman comes up, and so Jehu now, and so he said, thus and thus he spoke to me, saying, thus says the Lord, I have anointed you king over Israel. He's still trying to process that. Can you imagine that? I mean, he's still trying to make sense of what just happened and the implications of that, and what does that actually mean? And now, you know, he's been this faithful commander, and now he's been told to go execute the king that he's been serving, but that God is the one that's directing him to do that, and not just to execute him, but he is the next king over Israel. And so he tells the officers that were sitting there, you know, what's just transpired. And verse 13, it says, and then each man hastened to take his garment and to put it under him on the top of the steps, and they blew trumpets saying, Jehu is king. They put their cloaks onto the steps so that Jehu could walk down on their cloaks, a sign of their support and of him. And they blew the trumpet saying, Jehu is king. And so these were customary rituals for announcing a king. So they are all in behind Jehu. And now Jehu, verse 14, he begins. It says, so Jehu, the son of Jehoshaphat, the son of Nimshi, conspired against Joram. Now, Joram had been defending Ramoth-Gilead, he and all Israel, against Hazael, king of Syria. But King Joram had returned to Jezreel to recover from the wounds which the Syrians had inflicted on him when he fought with Hazael, king of Syria. And Jehu said, if you are so minded, let no one leave or escape from the city to go and to tell it in Jezreel. And so Jehu rode in a chariot and went to Jezreel, for Joram was laid up there, and Ahaziah, king of Judah, had come down to see Joram. So he wants to immediately then go to Jezreel, to where he knows now that Joram is. And so he tells his men to make sure that no one leaves the city. That's what I want you to do right now, so that no one can beat him to Jezreel now and to announce what has just happened. So he wants the element of surprise as he is going to go there. He knows that Joram is there, and he also knows that now the king of Judah, so remember we have the divided kingdoms, and so Israel and Judah, and he knows that the king of Judah is visiting in Jezreel, Joram, who is there, and so now Jehu heads out in his chariot and heads for Jezreel. Verse 17. It says, now a watchman stood on the tower in Jezreel, and he saw the company of Jehu as he came. And he said, I see a company of men. And Joram said, get a horseman and send him to meet them, and let him say, is it peace? So Joram is in the city, and they see a cloud of dust. And so they know that there is a multitude, a small multitude that is coming. But they don't know who it is, and so he orders one of his horsemen to go intercept the convoy and to find out what's going on. Verse 18, so the horseman went to meet him and said, thus says the king, is it peace? So when he asks him, is it in peace, he's asking him, how is the battle going? Is everything okay? And so he's asking him about that. And Jehu said, what have you to do with peace? Turn around and follow me. And so the watchman reported, saying, the messenger went to them, but is not coming back. So he goes, and Jehu says, you know, what have you to do with peace? Now, the slang of that, what that really means is, don't worry about the situation. He comes out and he's driving hard. Jehu is driving hard to Jezreel. And so the horseman comes out to him and says, is it peace? And he says, don't worry about it. Everything's okay. Now, remember that Jehu is the commander of the army. And so, he says, just fall in line and return with me, because they're all heading back. Now, he has no reason to believe that there is anything afoul that is going on here. And so he just falls in lines with them, and he's returning with them. And so the watchman reports that and says, the messenger went to them, but is not coming back. Verse 19, then he sent out a second horseman who came to them and said, thus says the king, is it peace? And Jehu answered, what have you to do with peace? Turn around and follow me. And so don't worry about the situation. Everything's okay. Come on, let's go back together. That's what he's telling them. And so now the watchman is watching this, and that's the second horseman that goes out and then just falls in with the company and starts to head back. And so so the watchman reported, he went up to them and is not coming back. And the driving is like the driving of Jehu, the son of Nimshi, for he drives furiously. So the watchman, he can't tell who it is, but he sees how the chariot is being driven. And so he knows how Jehu drives his chariot, like a wild man, and so I think it was a sports car. And he's driving it in such a fashion that he is discernible for his driving. Now, I don't know exactly what it means to drive furiously, but I do know that my wife likes to tell me that sometimes I'll be talking to her and driving, and I won't be as assertive in my driving if we're late or otherwise, and Amber will turn to me and she'll say, will you drive like you mean it? And so that's one of the phrases that should drive like you mean it, and I'm like, okay, boom, and we are off. So I just want you to know, if I go flying by you sometime, it's only because I'm driving like I mean it. Here we see that Jehu is driving like he means it. He is driving furiously, is what it says here. And then Joram said, make ready. And his chariot was made ready. And then Joram, king of Israel, and Ahaziah, king of Judah, went out, each in his chariot. And they went out to meet Jehu and met him on the property of Naboth the Jezreelite. Now, remember the prophecy was on the very grounds there, that's where the bloods are going to lick. So they actually end up now on the very property of Naboth. And so Jehu is thinking, you know, he is, or rather, Joram is thinking that Jehu is bringing bad news of the fighting that's going on in Ramoth-Gilead. Remember, that's where he had been injured. He had been wounded, and then he comes back to Jezreel. And so now he wants an update on what's going on. And so he rides out to meet Jehu and to get the news himself as quickly as possible to know how the battle is going with the Syrians. In verse 22, now it happened when Joram saw Jehu that he said, "Is it peace, Jehu?" And so he answered, "What peace, as long as the harlotries of your mother Jezebel and her witchcraft are so many?" So I guess it's not peace then, would be the answer here to his question. And here's the interesting thing, is that when Joram is asking him, "Is it peace?" he wasn't asking him, "Is it peace between you and me?" because this is the commander of his army. He's asking, "Is there peace in Ramoth-Gilead? Is everything okay in Ramoth-Gilead?" And so the answer now, we see the peace that suddenly he's talking about now is the peace of the land that is going on, because the Jezebel's idolatry has ruined Israel's peace with God, because sin always separates us from God. And so they were in complete rebellion against God, and so there was no peace with God. Whenever we're serving sin, we're in rebellion against God. And so here we see that now, verse 23, then Joram turned around and fled and said to Ahaziah, "Treachery, Ahaziah!" And now Jehu drew his bow with full strength and shot Jehoram between his arms, and the arrow came out at his heart, and he sank down in his chariot. So Jehu shot him fatally with an arrow. He probably did not have his armor on because he was just coming out quickly to see what was going on, plus his own injuries as well. And so the fatal blow struck easily, and Jehu was at close range and was a warrior here. And so he kills him. Verse 25, and then Jehu said to Bidkar, his captain, "Pick him up and throw him into the tract of the field of Naboth, the Jezreelite. For remember when you and I were riding together behind Ahab, his father, that the Lord laid this burden upon him. Surely I saw yesterday the blood of Naboth and the blood of his sons, says the Lord, and I will repay you in this plot, says the Lord. Now therefore, take and throw him on the plot of ground according to the word of the Lord." Now, it's interesting here because we see that there is more information. We knew that Jezebel had killed Naboth, but here we find out that she didn't just kill Naboth. She killed Naboth and also his sons here as well, we discover. And so he reminds his captain now in the chariot, "Remember when we were behind Ahab? And do you remember when Elijah said these things to him?" And so he reminds him now of these things. And so he says to take Jehoram and to throw him now onto the tract of ground there of Naboth, and throw him on the tract in fulfillment of the scriptures. And so, verse 27, it says, "But when Ahaziah, king of Judah, saw this, he fled by the road to Beth Hagan. So Jehu pursued him and said, 'Shoot him also in the chariot.' And they shot him at the ascent of Gur, which is by Iblim. And then he fled to Megiddo and died there. And his servants carried him in the chariot to Jerusalem. and buried him in his tomb with his fathers in the city of David. In the 11th year of Joram, the son of Ahab, Ahaziah had become king over Judah. So we see that Ahaziah of Judah also is killed here as well. Now, remember that God has commissioned Jehu to go and to cut off the posterity of Ahab. And so Joram and his descendants here as well. But this also includes Jezebel. And so we see in verse 30, now when Jehu had come to Jezreel, Jezebel heard of it, and she put paint on her eyes and adorned her head and looked through a window. And then as Jehu entered at the gate, she said, "Is it peace, Zimri, murderer of your master?" So hearing of Jehu's return, we see that that Jezebel now goes and fixes her hair and puts on her makeup. And so she is defiant all the way to the end. As Jehu comes into the city gates, she is up above looking out from her window. Now, Zimri, you will remember that Zimri rebelled against his master, Elah. That's back in 1 Kings chapter 16. And so when she says, you know, "Is it peace, Zimri, murderer of your master?" She knows that Jehu has killed her son. And he was supposed to be loyal because he was the commander of the army and killed him. So she references Jehu and calls him Zimri because Zimri was the commander of the army that had done the same thing to his master. And so so we see here that another translation of that, when she says, you know, "Is it peace, Zimri, murderer of your master?" In the NIV, it says, "Did Zimri have peace who murdered his master?" In other words, she was reminding him of what happened to Zimri. Now, Zimri himself, after 7 days, was killed. And so it didn't go well for Zimri. And so what she's basically saying is, do you think that you're going to prosper? Do you think that you're going to get away with this? And it is defiant right to the end here as Jehu now enters into the city. Verse 32, "And he looked up at the window and he said, 'Who is on my side?'" So Jehu now cries out, "Who is on my side?" and calls up to the window, "Who?" And so two or three eunuchs looked out at him. And then he said, "Throw her down." So they threw her down, and some of her blood splattered on the wall and on the horses, and he trampled her underfoot. This would not be PG if this was a movie right here. We have got full disclosure going on here of what happens. And so she's up in, you know, in the queen's quarters there in the window, and Jehu just says, "Who is on my side?" Now, we see that the eunuchs that were there, they have to make a decision. If they protect her, Jehu is going to come up with the armed men, and then whoever stood with her is going to die with her. And so he calls out, you know, "Declare, who is with me?" And they have to make that decision right then. And so they declare that they're with Jehu. And so they pick her up and throw her out the window. And then she dies on the ground. And he trampled her underfoot. And so we see that in addition to her fall, we see that Jehu also uses his horse as well. In verse 34, "And when he had gone in, he ate and drank. And then he said, 'Go now, see to this accursed woman and bury her, for she was a king's daughter.'" So he's hungry, and he goes in and has a lunch. And during his lunchtime meal, he's thinking about the fact that, you know, probably shouldn't leave her laying trampled out in the street there. And so thinks maybe we should bury her. That would probably be because she was royalty. And so he is going to and give the command now. Go now and see. So they went to bury her, verse 35, but they found no more of her than the skull and the feet and the palms of her hands. So the wild dogs had come in and eaten her, and that was all that was left over now of Jezebel. And verse 36, and therefore they came back and told him. And he said, this is the word of the Lord. See, he didn't remember that Jezebel was not going to be buried. Remember that the prophecy was that she wasn't going to be buried. So we see that when he gives the command to have her buried, that's actually against the word of the Lord. So they go out now to get her, and they find out now that she has been eaten. And so then in verse 36, he remembers and he says, this is the word of the Lord, which he spoke by his servant Elijah the Tishbite, saying, on the plot of ground at Jezreel, dogs shall eat the flesh of Jezebel, and the corpse of Jezebel shall be as refuse on the surface of the field in the plot at Jezreel, so that they shall not say, here lies Jezebel. They didn't want, God was not going to allow her to be honored by having a grave and a marker, and that her body was going to be lying there. And so this was part of the judgment for the wickedness that she had brought upon the land. Now, 2 Kings 10, verse 1, we see that Ahab's sons now, the family members, that Jehu is going to continue to finish the job that he has been given. And it says, now Ahab had 70 sons in Samaria. And Jehu wrote and sent letters to Samaria, to the rulers of Jezreel, to the elders, and to those who reared Ahab's sons, saying, so we have the 70 of his descendants living there in Samaria. Now remember that Samaria was the capital of Israel. And so it says, now, verse 2, now as soon as this letter comes to you, since your master's sons are with you, and you have chariots and horses, a fortified city also, and weapons, choose the best qualified of your master's sons, set him on his father's throne, and fight for your master's house. So now that Joram has been killed, then there's going to be, you know, one of his sons is going to ascend to the throne. So we see that Jehu sends a letter to them, and the 70 are there in Samaria. It says, you have a walled city, you've got chariots, you've got weapons. Choose whichever one of the sons that you want to put onto the throne, and then we're going to attack. We are going to do battle with you, because we know that you're going to stand with your new king. In verse 4, it says, but they were exceedingly afraid. Remember that Jehu is the commander of the army. He's the general, and he's skilled in battle. And now he's saying that he's going to bring his forces against Samaria. So the army that's always fought for them is suddenly turned and is going to come against them. And it says in verse 4, but they were exceedingly afraid and said, look, two kings could not stand up to him. How then can we stand? He just killed the king of Judah and the king of Israel. And they're like, what chance do we have against him? In verse 5, and he who was in charge of the house, and he was in charge of the city, the elders also, and those who reared the sons, sent to Jehu saying, we are your servants. We will do all you tell us, but we will not make anyone king. Do what is good in your sight. They said, we're not going to fight. We're not going to anoint somebody as king. And they knew that Jehu would win a battle like this. And so they acquiesce in verse 6. So then he wrote a second letter to them, saying, if you are for me and will obey my voice, take the heads of the men, your master's sons, and come to me at Jezreel by this time tomorrow. And now the king's sons, 70 persons, were with the great men of the city who were rearing them. And so it was when the letter came to them that they took the king's sons and slaughtered 70 persons, put their heads in baskets, and sent them to him at Jezreel. So we find the officials did now exactly as Jehu had commanded. Verse 8, then a messenger came and told him, saying, they have brought the heads of the king's sons. And he said, lay them in two heaps at the entrance of the gate until morning. And so it was in the morning that he went out and stood and said to all the people, you are righteous. Indeed, I conspired against my master and killed him. But who killed all these? Know now that nothing shall fall to the earth of the word of the Lord, which the Lord spoke concerning the house of Ahab. For the Lord has done what he spoke by his servant Elijah. And so here we see that that once again, what Jehu is doing is he is telling them, I didn't kill all of these, the 70 that are there. The elders and the leaders of the city did. He says, you know, I did kill Joram and I didn't kill Ahaziah. He says, but they are the ones that killed these 70. But he also at the same time is letting them know, but they did this in fulfillment of the word of God, that this happened at God's direction. And so he is absolving them of the death of these 70 because this has been directed. This was directed by God through Elijah. Verse 11, so Jehu killed all who remained of the house of Ahab in Jezreel, and all his great men, and his close acquaintances, and his priests, until he left him none remaining. Now, here we see this is where Jehu goes too far. Jehu, up until this point, has been doing as he was instructed by the Lord. The 70, those were the descendants of Ahab, and those were coming underneath judgment directed by God. But now what Jehu does, look at what it says there, is that he also killed all of his great men, the men that were rearing those kids, and his close acquaintances and his priests, until he left none of them remaining. And so here we see that Jehu now kills innocent people who could have been a part of supporting him as a king. And we see that ultimately God doesn't approve this, and God is going to judge Jehu's own dynasty later. We're going to find out because of this here as well. Verse 12. And he arose and departed and went to Samaria. And on the way at Bethekad of the shepherds, Jehu met with the brothers of Ahaziah, king of Judah, and said, who are you? So there's 42 that are this group that are coming down. And so they answered, we are the brothers of Ahaziah, and we have come down to greet the sons of the king and the sons of the queen mother, Jezebel. So they didn't get the Twitter post of what has happened there. And so now verse 14, and he said, take them alive. And so they took them alive and killed them at the wall of Beth-Eked, 42 men, and he left none of them. Verse 15, now when he departed from there, he met Jehonadab, the son of Rechab, coming to meet him. And he greeted him and said to him, is your heart right as my heart is toward your heart? And Jehonadab answered, it is. And Jehu said, if it is, give me your hand. And so he gave him his hand and he took him up to him into the chariot. Now, he meets with Jehonadab, and Jehu now asks him, is your heart and towards me? And he says, yes, it is. And so they shake hands, and he brings them up into his chariot. In verse 16, he says, then he said, come with me and see my zeal for the Lord. And so they had him ride in his chariot. And when he came to Samaria, he killed all who remained to Ahab in Samaria till he had destroyed them according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke to Elijah. And so we see that purging the apostate influence of Ahab, we see that Jehonadab was in favor of that and the fulfillment of the word of the Lord. Now, as Jehu is the king over Israel, and as he has been called to be the instrument of judgment of the Lord upon the apostasy that has been in the land. And here we see the consequences and the judgment when we turn away from God. the end result is that we are always going to suffer a poorer quality of life. We are going to experience the lack of blessings that come from walking with the Lord and being with the Lord. And so now the nation Israel has been suffering underneath the consequences of the lack of blessings from God. And so we see that the Baal worship had taken over, and the people, they were worshiping the Lord, but they were also worshiping Baal. So they now, instead of being faithful, they were cheating on God, and they were going and worshiping the false god of Baal. So Jehu now takes out the house of Ahab, takes out Jezebel, takes out the descendants, but now he still has to cleanse and deal with the issue of the worship of Baal. And so here we see the way that he does that, verse 18. Then Jehu gathered all the people together. He's the new king. And he gathers all the people together, and he said to them, Ahab served Baal a little, but Jehu will serve him much. So he says, I am all about the worship of Baal. That's who I am. This is what Jehu is saying. Now, it's not true, but that's what he is now saying to the people as he says, Ahab worshiped him a little bit. He's my main God. And so he declares this to the people. Now, therefore, call to me all the prophets of Baal, all his servants and all his priests, and let no one be missing, for I have a great sacrifice for Baal, and whoever is missing shall not live. But Jehu acted deceptively with the intent of destroying the worshipers of Baal. So he says, I want a big feast to Baal. I want everybody that's a Baal worshiper. I want you all to come. Ollie, Ollie, oxen free, come on in, and we are going to all go worship Baal together. And Jehu said, proclaim a solemn assembly for Baal. And so they proclaimed it. And then Jehu sent throughout all Israel, and all the worshipers of Baal came, so that there was not a man left who did not come. And so they came into the temple of Baal. And the temple of Baal was full from one end to the other. It was packed out. And he said to one in charge of the wardrobe, bring out vestments for all the worshipers of Baal. And so he brought out vestments for them. So the whole enchilada is going on here in verse 23. Then Jehu and Jehonadab, the son of Rechab, went into the temple of Baal and said to the worshipers of Baal, search and see that no servants of the Lord are here with you, but only the worshipers of Baal. And so he says, I want to make sure that there aren't any worshipers here of the true and the living God. If you're a worshiper of the true and the living God, you're at the wrong party. You need to leave right now, and you need to make your way into the exits. And so they searched to make sure that there were no worshipers of the Lord that were there. And so we see, search and see that no servants, verse 24. So they went in to offer sacrifices and burnt offerings. Now Jehu had appointed for himself 80 men on the outside and had said, if any of the men whom I have brought into your hands escapes, whoever lets him escape, it shall be his life for the life of the other. So that's pretty serious. He says, if anybody comes out, you're to slay them. If you let them go, whoever lets anybody get by them, your life is going to be paid for their life. In verse 25, and now it happened, as soon as he had made an end of offering the burnt offering, then Jehu said to the guard and to the captains, go in and kill them. Let no one come out. And they killed them with the edge of the sword Then the guards and the officers threw them out and went into the inner room of the temple of Baal. And so they go in now to destroy all the Baal worshipers. It says in verse 26, and they brought the sacred pillars out of the temple of Baal and burned them. And then they broke down the sacred pillar of Baal and tore down the temple of Baal and made it a refuse dump to this day. And thus Jehu destroyed Baal from Israel. Woohoo! We see the destruction now. Remember Elijah and his battle with the prophets of Baal up on Mount Carmel. And you remember that there were the 300 prophets that were destroyed on that day there. But they continued to rise up and Baal worship continued underneath Jezebel as she was there. But now as Jehu has taken out Jezebel, we see that he goes after the Baal worship and he cleanses the land. And so Jehu destroyed Baal from Israel. Verse 29, though, it says, however, Jehu did not turn away from the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel sin, that is, from the golden calves that were at Bethel and Dan. Now, remember that when Israel broke away from Judah, that they didn't want to have to go and worship at the temple and to say that is the true temple of the Lord. So they had made their golden calves and set them up there at Dan and Bethel. And so here we see that Jehu continues to allow those golden calves in the worship there. Verse 30, and the Lord said to Jehu, because you have done well in doing what is right in my sight, and have done to the house of Ahab all that was in my heart, your sons shall sit on the throne of Israel to the fourth generation. And so God blesses Jehu for faithfully carrying out his will in judgment against the house of Ahab. And so four generations are going to sit on the throne. Verse 31. But Jehu took no heed to walk in the law of the Lord God of Israel with all his heart, for he did not depart from the sins of Jeroboam, who had made Israel sin. And so even though he was faithful to execute God's will, he doesn't worship God. He doesn't study his word. He's not a good king. He allows the political idolatry, which was to set up their own worship place in Israel instead of going to the temple there in Jerusalem. And so he never quite yields himself fully to devoting himself to God. It's interesting because God had chosen him to become the next king over Israel. Here he was the commander, and God anoints him as king and honors him and establishes four generations to come after him. But there is still a failure in his heart to truly worship God, even though God had blessed him mightily. May that be just a warning to each and every one of us that God can use us, but we need to be fully given over to the Lord. And God will bless us. But the tragedy is if we still try and operate in our own mechanisms instead of yielding fully to God's will. What is God's will? And to just yield to it fully and totally. And so here we see in verse 32, we're going to see some of God's discipline then upon Jehu. Yes, four generations, he is blessed for his actions here, but his lack of intimacy, his lack of commitment, his lack of communion and fellowship has consequences. And so we're going to see here some of the consequences that transpire. Jehu gets off to a great start, and imagine what could have been if Jehu now had yielded fully to God and to the heart of God. But it says now in verse 32, in those days, the Lord began to cut off parts of Israel. And so he starts to allow Israel's enemies to start to have victory over Jehu and to start to take back territory that now was in possession of Israel. And so the Lord began to cut off parts of Israel, and Hazael conquered them in all the territory of Israel. So that's Syria. And verse 33, from the Jordan eastward, all the land of Gilead, Gad, Reuben, and Manasseh, from Aroer, which is by the river Arnon, including Gilead and Bashan. And so we see God's discipline for Jehu's incomplete devotion. Verse 34, now the rest of the acts of Jehu, all that he did, and all his might, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Israel? And so Jehu rested with his fathers, and they buried him in Samaria. And then Jehoahaz, his son, reigned in his place. And the period that Jehu reigned over Israel in Samaria was 28 years. And so God uses Jehu as an instrument to cleanse the Baal worship. And now that apostasy is driven out. May God speak to us in our own hearts and in our own lives. And the question that we have to ask ourselves, is there any Baal worship that's going on in our life? Notice that the Baal worship wasn't a turning away from the true and the living God. It was in addition to. It was just a lack of complete devotion. It was a having one foot in the right camp and one foot in the wrong camp. And so the worship of Baal would be a typology of carnality. And so as we are the spiritual man, and we are called to put to death the carnal man, Baal worship would be the compromise of allowing now the fulfillment of the carnal man while still trying to be that spiritual man. And if that's where we are tonight, then may we, like Jehu, just put to death the carnal man. May there be peace in our hearts and in our lives, and may there be a singular devotion to the things of God and to his will in our life. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you do cleanse the land, that you do judge evil, that you do drive it out. And so, God, in our own hearts, in our own lives, would you drive it out, Lord? And would you give us clean hands and pure hearts, Lord? And Father, would you do a new work in each and every one of us? Wash us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness, God. Bless our homes, bless our marriages, bless our families, bless our workplace, our neighborhoods, Lord. Bless our city, Father. Bless our nation. Help us, Father, shine brightly for you. We love you, God. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.